I'm Tracy Baxter with today's Record News Watch.
I come home from work. I get out of work at 10. I come home and I couldn't get it through the underpass, so I went around over the railroad tracks and I come home to this.
What was going on was a violent thunderstorm that ripped through Gloria's neighborhood and other parts of the city of Port Jervis and nearby Matamoras last evening, bringing down trees, flooding streets, and cutting power. Gloria lives on 2nd Street in the section of Port Jervis known as the Acre, where the neighborhood was rocked by thunder, high winds, lightning strikes, and hail.
All of a sudden, hail balls started coming down, and our backyard just started looking like a complete war zone after a while. Our umbrellas were flying out of the tables, and my fence broke in half and got on top of my truck and caused a lot of damage. I was pretty terrified when the lightning, we had our back door open when my husband was cooking dinner, and I was terrified from the lightning because it almost looked like it was coming into my kitchen.
The heavy rain flooded out the Pike Street underpass, diverting traffic and making it difficult for Orange and Rockland repair crews to access trouble spots, including River Road, which remained closed earlier today so that utility workers could rebuild wrecked utility poles and transmission lines. At the height of the storm, around 6,000 utility customers in the Port Jervis, Matamoras areas were without power. Port Jervis Mayor Kelly Decker says while there's a damage to repair, it could have been a lot worse.
I got to tell you something. Port Jervis pulls together. The people come out and volunteer. We have the volunteer fire department and, just neighbors helping neighbors. And things have been put together this morning. You know, we still have some remnants. We have a couple of commercial buildings that the roofs need to be looked at and replaced. Behind me, Orange and Rockland still working on the power lines on River Road. And some trees need to be cut up. Basements were pumped out and people assess that damage. And otherwise, we're doing okay.
Oh, and our spokesman Mike Donovan said all the outages were expected to be repaired and all customers back online by late this afternoon. Brave and heroic. That's how Ellenville Police Chief Phil Matrician described the 72-year-old woman who fought off an armed robber at a local food market. According to police, 20-year-old Alexander Bamba walked into Orlando's food market on Market Street, pulled out a pistol and pointed it in the woman's face and demanded money. She grabbed the gun and a struggle began, and when she removed the sweatshirt that was covering his face, police say Bamba ran off. Within an hour, police were able to track him to a house on Warren Street where he was found hiding in a basement. He was there taken into custody there. Police say the weapon and other evidence was also found in the basement. Bamba's facing charges of first-degree robbery, criminal possession of a weapon, and falsely reporting an incident. Allenville police say Bamba had called in a report of an assault in a different part of the village in an attempt to distract police from the robbery scene. State police are asking anyone who witnessed yesterday's fatal two-car crash in the town of Wallkill to give them a call. The accident happened shortly after 11 Thursday morning on Route 211 and Fitzgerald Drive when a vehicle driven by 80-year-old William Utterman of Middletown collided with an SUV driven by 65-year-old Thomas Decker of Walden. Utterman died of his injuries. Decker was listed in serious condition after being airlifted to Westchester Medical Center. The state police telephone number is 845-344-5300. The locals remember it as a medium security prison. Before that, it served as a training school for boys. Now the push is on to market part of the Mid-Orange Correctional Facility property in the town of Warwick for future economic development. The state closed the prison off Kings Highway back in 2011. The 730-acre property was transferred to the town and its local development corporation, which is currently working to market it as the Warwick Valley Office and Technology Corporate Park. While the bulk of the land will remain undeveloped for environmental protection and recreation, 150 acres, including the existing buildings, are on the market, along with nearby shovel-ready development sites. Warwick Town Supervisor Mike Sweeten says area residents are hoping to see tax rateables and jobs spring up at a place now dominated by prison buildings and razor wire.
I think they are expecting that they have some small to medium-sized firms, maybe an eclectic mix of things, some technology companies, maybe some recreation companies, small manufacturing, something that will create jobs and for the first time ever in the history of this property, pay some property taxes. So I think that's the expectation. We have a lot of interest from some local companies in coming here and getting different portions of it, smaller buildings. So the LDC is very attuned to wanting to support and encourage local businesses.
Reporter James Walsh will have a full report on the plans for the former Warwick prison site, as well as the possible development options in an upcoming edition of the Times-Herald Record and here at Record Online. In other news, town of Wallkill police detectives have arrested a Newburgh man for his role in the August 11th home invasion robbery that occurred at a residence at 945 Goshen Turnpike. 21-year-old Antoine Cohn was arrested at his 3rd Street residence in Newburgh, charged with first-degree robbery. At the time of the incident, town police said three men, one armed with a handgun, had stolen an undisclosed amount of money from the 23-year-old victim. Following his arraignment, Cohn was sent to Orange County Jail on $100,000 cash bail. A Middletown man has been handed a 9-year prison sentence for his role in a shooting last December outside an Otisville tavern. 24-year-old Kevin Brennan Jr. had pleaded guilty to a first-degree assault charge. Brennan had shot and seriously wounded another man in gunfire that erupted during a dispute at the Victory Lane Bar and Grill in Otisville. The victim's brother, who fired gunshots at Brennan, also faces charges. And tens of thousands of visitors were expected to make the annual pilgrimage today to the cemetery at Kiryas Joel to pray at the gravesite of Grand Rebbe Joel Teitelbaum, the Holocaust survivor and founder of the Satmar Hasidic Jewish sect that settled the village of Kiryas Joel. The arrival of followers occurs on the anniversary of Rabbi Teitelbaum's death in 1979. The village of Kiryas Joel was incorporated in his name in 1977 as a satellite to the enclave he established in Brooklyn after World War II. Sunday should be the better day this weekend weather-wise. It'll be mostly cloudy on Saturday with some breaks of sunshine. The high Saturday will be in the upper 70s. Sunday will be partly sunny and pleasant with temperatures getting up around 80 degrees. We'll get an edge on the day by starting it with the Times-Herald Record. And anywhere news breaks this weekend, you will find it right here at Record Online. For Record News Watch, I'm Tracy Baxter. ¶¶